negative.
Yep. Service error might lose it again here periodically, so just kind of be prepared for that, guys. You know, going out west and stuff like that, cell service is spotty, so I try to keep it coming back as much long as I can, but if it cuts out, just be patient with me.
those wagons rolling.
Rolling, rolling, rolling.
What? Stop what?
Rolling, rolling, rolling.
Rolling,
keep them wagons rolling.
I'm
rawhide.
Not, I can't do rawhide.
I love rawhide.
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 There you go.
While you're still finishing your thought, I could not do it. Yeah. That's multitasking on a level that I have no idea how you do that. It's amazing. And now you're done. You're gonna do it.
So we've done the driver's booth in New Hampshire a couple times, where it was me, Tart, and Bert.
Right.
And those races, when Rick's not there, you really learn that how Rick is the most valuable part of the team. He is the most valuable part of the team. It's gonna be fun trying to do that, and hopefully I don't do too terribly bad.
And that's it, Richmond, you said?
Richmond.
All right.
Yeah.
So that's coming up in a couple weeks.
Yes.
Next week. So
I'm already nervous.
I would be too.
So I've always wanted to do this so badly for like 6 years, probably more than that. I wanted to start an eBay store. So, I have a lot of things that I've accumulated over the years, laying around, literally, like I told you, just stuff laying around. So, RC cars, all right, got piles of that stuff.
me that I'm never going to mess with. Brand new motors, gas-powered engine blocks, I mean, and boxes, not even used, brand new. Bodies, Lexan bodies. Old story.
I've got model
rockets and stuff.
I was into that for
a couple months and bought a bunch of stuff and never, they're brand new. I used to have a real fun part.
I remember just saying, Rose, the Jazz, or Flowers, and Jets.
And so we had cups and flat sticks and all that stuff.
Or something, you know.
Box.
Yeah, two more.
Never
gonna
mess with. So,
check out Sherry's Berries.
Old helmets.
I don't know if she likes chocolate covered strawberries or whatever.
That we had people come ride over
chocolate, chocolate cover. I should say chocolate dip.
All these helmets.
You get flowers and stuff like that. That's what I do for a life.
So, I'm gonna start a store.
Part of me thought you already had but I guess not. You just do all the buying. You buy.
Well, I do buy. And I did sell a lot of stuff with that account, but it was like cycling stuff. I bought a bunch of cycling stuff that I didn't need yet. So I sold a bunch of cycling stuff, which was nice because I kind of got some of my money back. But I'm going to try. I've been wanting to start a store, but I needed a partner because I need somebody that can understand what the price point is for each item, get a little bit of history of the pro stuff and all that. So basically, I think might be
right
good idea.
Here.
Right. I'm going to get a partner, and I'll provide the item, and the partner can take 30% or 25%.
I'm not sure, but it looks like
I was going to say, I hope you don't have a partner to trade.
I think I've got my partner, but I'm pretty out.
Could be
30% is
30%,
great.
30%, yeah.
I put my hat on 25%.
Yeah. Well, hold on. You're already negotiating against them. Do you even know who this person might be?
I know.
Okay.
I'm just saying.
Give him a cut. Okay. Yes.
Give him a cut.
Yeah. Because it sounds like they're going to be doing a lot of the legwork.
Yes. And then you get rid of your stuff. So it's a win-win.
Your value here is that the things are yours. Yeah. The value for them is they get to do the work and then they get a cut of it. That's fair.
My property and the accumulation makes me feel like that I basically have a 40 vision.
Ooh, yeah.
So
you're close.
Yeah, very close. A hoarding scenario going on.
The difference is the hoarding scenario that you've got going on, a lot of them are really super cool stuff.
Yes.
But, you know, hoarders are saving the box of macaroni and cheese from 1960.
It's feeling some of these, all this crap, like, stuff, right? It's just junk to me. And it is. It's old stuff laying around. A lot of it's a decade or more older. RC stuff that I'm never going to use. Model cars that I bought that I'm never going to put together. When I'm gone, I don't want Amy or Isla have to fool with it. Garbage, it's just not going to be nothing.
Plus, it's still relevant now, so why not get rid of it so somebody can use it?
So I'm going to start a store and offload some of this stuff. Because I'm feeling some anxiety, like it's a ball of chain.
That's on that hole.
All the stuff that you have?
Yeah, I'm pinned to this sort of geographical location due to the junk that's accumulated in that space.
Maybe you are a hoarder. By definition, hoarders are, you know, it affects your life in negative ways. Maybe you are actually hoarding.
I think so.
Just think when you clean your house, how good it feels when you sit there and look around. So that'll be the same for you, probably.
So I don't know much about what it means to be a store owner on eBay. So
I don't either.
Okay.
I know. I got this one shelf that goes to ceiling of RC car stuff. It's old. I mean, cars that are still in the box that never feel like gas. We were at a gas power pool with that stuff. I don't know. I mean, a couple hundred bucks would have paid for that stuff. I might get at least 50% of my money back.
Did you say that you had like model kits? Is there like value from a what am I trying to say?
They're old.
Yeah.
But they're from the 60s.
And if they're still in the package.
Yeah, they're still wrapped.
Yeah, those like people that would buy that have no intention of actually building it. They want to keep it like that. They're like baseball
cards. That's why I bought them.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. I bought them as in a collecting motive.
Gotcha.
And now I'm not here. I feel like they are tying down.
What scale?
Model car, whatever they're. What scale is the model?
Like no, they're RCs.
Oh, all of them. 10 scale, 8 scale, 12 scale. Quarter scale, any scale you want. You know what? I got some stuff that you guys want.
I know a lot of people would be interested.
I'll show you my eBay. Got a lot of nitro gas stuff.
Stop just for a second. Can you tell us about Zip Recruiter?
Yes, I can. Running a company right now, it's tough. And hiring can be even tougher. You have to fill a job. And on top of that, you have social distancing, supplying masks, and all those things. But you know who can help?
Who?
Different people.
James Frazier.
Check this out. So, Monica Starch, she can relate to that challenge. She needed to hire a pivotal role her construction company, GS Group, but having a tough time finding the right person, especially with so many candidates out there, she switched to ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter doesn't depend on candidates finding you, finding them for you. This technology identifies people who write a piece for your job, actively writes them to apply for you. So this is why you should try ZipRecruiter for free at ZipRecruiter.com/LG. That's how Monica found Lamont Jenkins. She said that ZipRecruiter sent Lamont's profile to her around 5 minutes after she had posted her job. And he was a great match for the role. Through ZipRecruiter, Monica's company has hired Air Crew One from accountants, project managers, field scientists. But Monica's not the only employer who loves ZipRecruiter. 4 out of 5 employers who post on ZipRecruiter get a quality candidate for the first day. See for yourself how ZipRecruiter is hiring fast. Obvious. Why?
Because that's boring. I'm gonna tell you, it's gonna be LeBron.
I think Harvick edges out Ham. For some reason, I think this has been sort of Denny's by far. Denny's best year ever. And I think he's coming very close. I just don't know who it's gonna happen. It's very clear what Harvick's done. Harvick's tied Kyle and wins. We're likely going to finish the season with Kyle and wins. I think it is the second title. This is how we can work quietly.
Yeah, and he's certainly the favorite. And I tell you what, that championship race in Phoenix could set up better for him. He's in that final four because that is his track.
Who's the dark one?
Well, gosh, I mean, listen, you could make an argument that any dark horse is anybody not named Harvick or Hamlin, frankly. But I don't know. Who do you think? I mean, so here's who you got here. Your
guys that aren't highlighted there are non-winners.
Right. So the winners are Harvick, Hamlin, Kozlowski, Logano, Chase Elliott, Martin Truex Jr., Ryan Blaney, Alex Bowman, William Byron now, this past weekend, Austin Dillon and Cole Custer. And then 12 through 16 is Amarola, Boyer, Kyle Busch, Kurt Busch, and then 16 is Benedetto.
I think Ryan Blaney.
Well, I tell you what, I'm looking at these like the tracks that go, the last four, Kansas,
I guess,
Texas,
we ain't
Martinsville,
Phoenix.
I'm just trying to see if those tracks are set up like that.
I guess we ain't going 80 mile an hour anymore. I was running away from you, and then I caught up to them, and I can't pass them for some reason, but I keep running down. I don't get it.
Is it dark horse?
I don't get it.
This is a good one this year.
That's why you had me.
Yeah.
Okay, let's hear it.
Who's not making it through the first round? Austin, Dillon, Cole Custer, Bush. So I think the same second man.
Right. You're saying the Benedetto will make it.
What? I guess the last question before we wrap that up is, who's one of the top guys you think will win?
Oh yeah. Well,
give me a guy in the top eight. Let's go even harder. Top seven: Ryan Blaney, Martin Truex, Peter Chase Elliott, Joey Logano, Brad Keselowski, Denny Hamlin, Kevin Harvick. Which one of those is most vulnerable to missing the first round?
I think it's easy, Joey Logano, because it's two short tracks and he's had a target on his back for himself. He's my championship.
Drivers don't target each other.
They should.
Well, they don't.
I know.
Close that theory.
Could be.
I think somebody's going to get some paper.
It could happen when you got three physical tracks. Well, two real physical tracks.
Good. All right.
Not against Joey. I love Joey.
You said Joey because you don't think he has a good spotter. What did you say?
I think Joey's
gonna win the title, but he's the biggest risk.
I wish Joey would get paid back.
I'll say Truex.
All right, I'm going to say Brad.
Yeah. The three races are Darlington, Richmond, and Bristol, so anything can just happen at those tracks. I'm telling you. So, like, you're right.
Yeah, Brad should have said.
All right. Before we bring in our guest Ross Chastain, let's talk a little bit about dressing up now. Indochino
suits are great for weddings and work.
The same, you can wear the same suit.
Yeah, for weddings
and work.
And they even offer casual options like shirts, coats, and chinos.
It's called Indo. Just put the chino down.
I got a wedding invite.
I got to look good. Keep me the one dressed down. There's always that one person. Wait. Pick it up. Not gonna be me.
Oh, pick up.
Pick up your game.
Are you gonna go with a casual option on your shirt? Or coat?
Well, a lot of times they determine what that is, but no, I'm gonna look good.
Your choice would be good for work too.
Well, if I went this route, I guess it would be good.
Well, that's what you gotta do. We need you to see your work, save options.
Yeah, what if I did a show like that?
I'm just saying, they're great for weddings and work, so whatever you buy, Mike, be prepared
to wear it to work.
With Indochino, you can get custom fitted suits, coats, and casual. They're in surprisingly affordable prices if you're getting married or buddies. Indochino is a no-brainer for you and your groomsmen. Forget off the rack suits and don't fit with different body types. Indochino gives everyone a tailored fit. Visit one of the Indochino showrooms across North America or book a virtual appointment and shop online at Indochino.com. And right now, you'll get $30 off any purchase of $399 or more when you enter code Dale Jr. at checkout. That's Indochino.com. Promo code Dale Jr.
Person.
I know, we do too. And, you've been on the show before. We had a great time. So we're glad to have you back again. That's exciting for me, getting return guests. The reason why you're here, man, we're going to talk about here in a bit. But first off, you're having an incredible season. I mean, I know that you are dying to get yourself a win, get your team a win. They hired you to win races. I know that that's running through your brain. But you are, without a doubt, numbers don't lie, that you're most consistent driver on the circuit. So where do you sort of net out with all that, with your Xfinity ride with Colleague, trying to get the win versus now you're going into the playoffs in a few weeks to battle for the championship? So are you viciously kind of going after this victory before the playoffs start so you can go ahead and check that box? Because once the playoffs start, you sort of have to go into championship mode and just piling up points. What's the approach?
Man, I don't know how to change, to be honest. I've heard guys forever growing up watching this sport talk about points racing and looking at the bigger picture, but especially now with no practice of qualifying, we just get these cars to race. So for me, it's just about
counting down the road here, John.
And for myself, I feel like I try to put quality, high percentage passes and moves together. Now, I did not do that this past weekend. I think once we down the stretch here, I just try to drive my race car as fast as I can and put it in the best spots and manipulate it as best I can. And that's not going to change a whole lot. Now we have Talladega in our playoffs in the Xfinity Series, which is new. So, I don't know how I'll handle that race. It'll probably depend on the point we're at in the points. Last year in the Truck Series, I was able to get in late, but get in and run for a championship there as the first real quality effort. And I got Talladega in their playoffs in the Truck Series, and I was just like, well, crash and crash. And that was a terrible mistake. I should have been a lot more conscious of the situation I was in. Barely made it through that round because I put some big holes to go for the win. So probably have to look at that race at Talladega a little different. We'll need to be that high risk pass at the end. All the other races, all the downforce races, I don't really know how I would drive different.
How do you look at your career or where you are now? Are you still sort of pinching yourself, or is that kind of worn off and now you're focused on this path?
got your, you might not feel this. It's funny because he will probably feel completely different than the perception that I have of this situation. My perception of your situation, and I think it's probably common for most people, is that you've kind of finally gotten some roots in a reasonably great race car. I mean, this is a great race team that's grown a lot over the last couple of years. So you're in a winning program, and it appears on the outside that you have some real stability and a sort of understanding of a path, right? But I bet, and I'm going to just guess, that you don't feel that security. You still feel like you're grinding and striving to survive, to make a career out of this, that you don't trust, I guess, that you have that stability in that. But, you know, you can kind of tell me, are you less anxious about your future than you might have been a year or two ago? Are you more confident that you might, you know, this might kind of win, you know, kind of work out and make itself into a 10, 20 year career? Because I remember when we talked on the show, you were like, I might go home. I might not, you know, this might not work out. I might be doing back of the family business in Florida one day. So where do you feel, how do you feel now? Because it looks stable, it looks secure, and people really see you as one of the bright prospects in our business.
I'm glad that we are faking it till we make it, as we might. we are. So, if we back up, and I don't want to get too far down this road because it's a tough subject for me and a lot of people. But the last time I was on your show, we really had the world by the tail, yes. And a lot changed in a short amount of time.
You had just announced that week the DC Solar sponsorship and the full ride at Ganassi in the Xfinity Series, and then he was on our show. And you were feeling great.
Yeah, man. I mean, I think we joked about getting myself tattooed and all that, and even a step further, the day that it, you know, technically all happened out west. Dale, you and I mean, it's a day that normally I would have never remembered. I mean, other than you're a great guy and I love eating sushi. But we went and ate lunch on Tuesday, and I had you sign two of your books for my grandmother's. And it's a day that I'll never forget because that's the day that the raid actually happened. And it had already happened that morning and I didn't know yet. And here we are eating sushi. And that's a day that it stands out in your mind, right? Well, I got those days for good or bad reasons. That night got the news of what happened and it all went down. But, you know, if we made it, we're still here. And that's the biggest thing. Like, we had to fight. And that put me with some different people. Behind the scenes, we all have a ton of people that support us. And I kept my core group stayed with me. Even on the front side of the business, the folks at Chip Ganassi Racing didn't just say, oh, well, too bad. Nice little group. Just they, Chip and Doug Newhart and those guys found a way to keep me in their family. Inspire, a big part of that on the sports and entertainment side, and now on the race team side with that coming along. So we all just kept fighting, and then you can bring in Nutrien Ag Solutions, right? We've got the hat on, there's no denying it. It's a great partnership. Elliot Sadler, Brett Griffin, bringing that to me. And I'd have some really heart-to-heart conversations with a lot of those people I just mentioned. Be like, look, we got to fight, we got to figure this out. So I never put it past that the current situation could change, and I don't know how any driver could be too sure these days, but I feel like that no matter what, we will find a way to keep fighting. So, no, I don't feel secure. I don't feel like, I can relax, and I don't feel like on the track or off the track. I mean, I want this to work so dang bad, and I want to be around for a long time. Retire early, just from working. And I know that job titles can change and stuff. And going back to the farm, I usually say it like it's a bad thing, but it's not. there as much as I can in these cars. And, you know, that, if that happens, like, I'm not afraid to go back. And, you know, I think Congress asked me a week or so ago, you know, what do you think next year looks like? And I'm like, man, I just hope I'm not farming watermelons. Like, you know, I want to be racing, so.
Listen, not to rehash old painful stuff, but for our listeners, we ought to at least clarify exactly what Ross is alluding to that happened a year and a half, 2 years ago, and that was his sponsor. He had a sponsor, they, you know, a full-time deal. We were so upbeat, we were so happy. Guilty, couldn't wait to get him on the show to talk about this, and we just had such a good time. Just a short time later, the sponsor ran into some legal troubles and federal legal troubles. Never recovered, I don't think. In fact, I think there was some news about their plea bargains and whatnot 3 weeks ago. So this thing is still an ongoing deal. But obviously, the racing deal fell apart and Ross was left after basically being dealt a hand that could win him the, what looked like could win him the poker main event. Now he's on the outside of the tournament, right? Again. And Ross, it's interesting, Dale, your perspective of that, talking about stability, because I would, Ross, I don't know if it's just unlucky. I don't know if you're superstitious. I, like, you have had a couple times where opportunities look promising, and then somehow, it, maybe not to the fullest, but, you know, the mat gets swiped out from under there. Even you were going to get Newman's ride for, you know, what, a couple months as he recovered this year. And then, and you were in that Roush thing, but then the pandemic hits, and Newman didn't actually end up missing any races when it was all said and told. So, it's interesting because, yeah, I would be a little skittish on getting too optimistic at this point. It sounds like you've been let down a couple times.
Yeah, but I mean, I do want to keep kind of, you know, the glass is never totally full, but it's not empty either, man. I mean, what, how in the world does, I mean, you know, it's terrible that Ryan got hurt at Daytona this year, and, you know, the fact that he walked out of that hospital was awesome.
Amazing.
But, world, an Xfinity, you know, driver at different manufacturer, in Chevrolet, and I've been working with him 3 years, you know, exclusively since 2015, and off and on before that. Really found a home there, and they've really helped me. And they, you know, they, you know, the Xfinity side is not like, you know, they're sending us cars back when I'm driving the red cars, and it's not like, you know, they're not sending us a street vehicle to drive. And but we got to go out to, you know, Ron Fellow's driving school for road course stuff and get new simulator dates along the way for road courses. And then here I am full time in college racing. I just ran a 77 car for Spire and Super Fantasy Racing. And Roush Lindley Racing store calls me. Like, and everybody agreed on it. I mean, that,
right.
That's the most incredible, you know, behind the scenes with the how usually this sport operates, how I understand it operates. That doesn't happen. And everybody agreed we needed the help. Those guys over at the Roush family needed help. We needed to help Ryan, and I was the guy that they wanted to put in it. Now, they told me I was the first guy. I don't know what it was, but we got the deal done where I could drive both cars and you know, Xfinity with Cog Racing on Saturdays and the Chevy. And then drive a Ford Cup car on Sunday. That's
unheard of.
That's incredible. So we just keep fighting through all the scenarios, and we'll come out with another shot.
In a really tight sort of short period of time, you raced for Roush, Spire, been behind the cloak, you know, been behind the doors of Chip Ganassi, racing a colleague Johnny Davis. What are you learning about how all these different companies operate? Because I think fans would be pretty surprised at the culture. And each one being so unique, not better, not worse, just different, how each company sort of approaches being successful. You're learning that from a lot of different companies in a really short time. And has that really surprised you? It kind of surprised me. I thought for the longest time that every race shop is the same. You know, there's race cars in there and guys that build them. And there's what could be different, you know? But there's a from the top down. From the owner down, there's a real change from shop to shop.
Yeah, for sure. I related to something I heard a long time ago, but that there's no bad employees, there's just bad bosses. And I believe that, like you said, there's not one really any better or worse than the next shop, but you're right, it all starts at the top. You know, just how they, you know, just being friendly and being really nice to each other. And yeah, we all have a business to work to make it where I can drive a race car in however, you know, that best suits each team. I've always got a lot of ideas, and I've got people that have a lot of ideas of how we can move the ball forward. And I'm just trying to fit into every group, though, is probably the biggest thing that I've learned is, like, I can't walk into the same group with, you know, the same attitude. Kind of got to pull to fit in. And I feel like as public spokespersons, as we all are, we're held to a little bit higher standard and got to rise to that, even if it's a thumb.
I think that you said that you had a hard time kind of understanding how to change your approach to racing when it comes to, you know, going all out and trying to win this race, or, man, I really need to finish these points. But you have to change quite a bit going from organization to organization, but the agenda of each organization is so different. Racing for Spire, they have a set few things that they really need to accomplish in that event. And some things that cannot happen in that event, right? Because the smaller teams, they can't afford to go for broke and take certain risks. Whereas, you know, when you're racing for maybe another team, you know, they can't, you know, go out there and really put that effort in to go for the race and, you know, take risks with their race cars and so forth. You know, your agenda for your race changes. So how do you manage that? I mean, you seem to do that really well, and I think that, you know, we hire drivers to do motorsports for that same reason, right? I brought Brad Keselowski in here because he was going to finish the race and take care of the equipment, and we couldn't learn unless we were finishing. If we were wrecking every weekend, we weren't learning nothing building race cars, but how to build good race cars.
We had done that.
So you seem to do that really well when you go from team to team, because you do this. You'll race for Spire in Darlington. You'll be in a colleague car with an entirely different agenda the day before. How easy is that? Or how hard is that? How challenging is that to finishing? Because Spire needs you to take care of their car, right? You're going to be in maybe the hardest race to do that, Darlington. That's a very difficult race to finish in one piece. So how does that work? You know, I've explained that to me. I've never really been in that situation. I could be just completely careless most of my career. So how do you deal with it?
It's tough, man. I will say that the Saturday Xfinity Saturday, currently, right, with college racing, like Ricky Ray, it's about trophies. That college wants trophies. We want to lead laps, win stages, win races, and do that as much as we can. And we don't want to tear up cars on the road team does, but they're willing to let me put the car at risk to do that. And then the gap to Sunday, right, like no further distance in the world than that walk from the Xfinity garage to the Cup garage. I heard that, and it's true. It's so true. And, but getting in the way I did in the Cup Series, with Jay Robinson and Premium Motorsports, with two races in Dover in 2017. That's all I did. That was scary, but we came out of there okay with our first race. Then we go to 2018 and 19, just for a little backstory. And I had two almost full years. I think I missed three races in 18 and one race in 19. I got to be in a Cup car every week, but we would qualify around 29th and 33rd. And, you know, I was racing, chasing the Benedetta the first year in 18 in the 32 car, and then I was chasing the Joy the second year in the 32 car. That was always our rabbit, but as long as we just stayed within one position of them, it was a good day. And, you know, I had for 2 years Jay Robinson, who owned Premium Motorsports at the time, and he was in my ear throughout the races, hey, this is a high risk restart, we need to just lay back, there's only 20 laps to go to the next stage break, we're going to keep these same tires on it, just don't go a lap down. And sometimes we'd go a lap down so that the guy behind us would not get the free pass, keep them a lap down, so the next run we didn't have to race hard either. So there was a lot of wisdom there. So I had 2 years of that in the Cup Series of just 30th place running. You know, in a good day would be 26th, 25th, and some attrition. Sometimes our goal was to say, like, a single-digit number of laps down. Like, Darlington, you know, you can easily go 6, 7, 7-8 laps down there, and it'd still be an okay day, but I never wanted to be double digits. Like 10 laps down, that's my line. So having that perspective, man, of 10 from 2 years of doing that, really helps that gap between the Xfinity race on Saturday and Christmas. And the problem I had, to be honest, was getting in 77 car with Chip Ganassi Racing and the 6 car with Kyle Stenberg Racing was tough. I knew then, you know, performance was, you know, at the top of this now and not, you know, not that they want a wreck car, but, and I would put those cars in just really high risk spots. Like, and I kind of tire down in Vegas, for example, racing on restart, you know, maybe 3 or 4 wide on those early, or, you know, mid race restarts. And kind of tire go a lap down, come back out, or passing. I think I'm catching Boyer in the 14. And we've got our car where I'm running almost wide open and clean air. And I catch him, and I don't anticipate how loose it's going to be. And I spin out and cause a late caution in the cup race. Don't hit anything, but the biggest thing that Jack had told me that week was, you're in this car because you're not going to tear it up. And here I go, cut a tire because I run into the one car, Kurt Busch told me. And then I spin out with, like, I don't know, 15 laps to go for no reason. I'm not racing anybody. And here I'm trying to run wide open around Vegas. And I spin out because I get in dirty air. So that's been my biggest struggle is performing in the Cup Series at the level these guys do. But being in control, I was not in control. And even with racing, driving over my head, I've got to be better next time. So that's been my biggest takeaway from this year's Cup race.
I'm not saying it's a perfect segue, but I do think that brings up an opportunity to ask you about Daytona this past weekend. All right, so let's all do it. Let's get there. All right. So first of all, the last lap, you're in second. Let's set the table here.
This is Mike's idea.
Dale Jr.'s in the booth, so he's watching and just enjoying the amazing race. And your teammate AJ Allmendinger's in the lead. And I guess you guys were like that for 8, 10 laps or something. And so, like, you had a chance to sort of, in your mind, set up how you were going to try to win this race. Now, to your credit, you have always said, listen, you are going to be aggressive. Everybody knows there's no questions that you're going to go try to win that race. There's also no question that AJ's going to turn wide, as you would. All right. Take us to the last lap. Or take quite a lap.
The race car driver does right. We got to back up a little bit here. I got to start with 4 to go. Was when I really started trying to figure out how to do something. Our kind of thought going into the race, and Chris Rice passes down, is like take care of each other until 10 to go. My number was 4 to go. I started backing up to the third place car. I started seeing what kind of run I could get. Our colleague racing cars are so fast, man. It's incredible. I mean, we can. Turn left, turn right, side right. We can do all the things, and the cars go right where you point them. They don't do anything weird. They don't. They keep their momentum. And obviously, fast cars and then 3 drivers that are really aggressive. We can carve up through the field and then restart, not in the front row. So, we took the white, and they were side by side behind me. I thought we lost because I just couldn't get the momentum to my back marker. Couldn't back up to the bike either side by side. So off of 2 in the final lap, I got the 11. Now they were backwards in my mind. I thought the 11 and the 1 car was swapped. But the 11 was on the top. He comes and gives me a huge shove and almost wrecks us. He actually lifts like halfway in the back stretch when he runs into me. But it gives me the run that I need, and I took it. And now I'm back in the race and I've got a shot. So my whole thought was get to AJ's right rear. I go low at the end of down to the yellow line at the end of the back stretch, and then I turn right, and I'm too far back. And in my mind, it's going slow motion, and I just see him go up, and I'm like, holy cow, he will open the bottom like I never thought he would. And I'm taking it. Like, here I go. Well, it was the ultimate, the best way I can describe it, like the ultimate sucker pull of all sucker bolts, and I took the bait. And in my mind, I had get his left rear, and Justin Haley is going to decide who wins this race. But we are going to be side by side. You know, whoever he pushes, we will have a colleague racing on our victory lane. But we might bump a little bit side to side, coming down the end of the trial, and he's left the bottom open for me. And as soon as I thought that, here he is blocking. And I just wish he would have done it more aggressively. The problem was, I took the high risk move to get there. You know, I should have just stuck to the top. And in hindsight, running on a quarterback, running on a race car driver, you can slow it down frame by frame. The hole that I saw was not there at all. And I just saw it for what I wanted to see it, and it's a problem.
I thought the hole was there. I did. I thought he came down, and I thought even his launch was a little delayed. I thought he came down a little slow. That was my impression. Of course, you bring up a good point. We rewind it, we pause it, we slow it. You don't have that opportunity, obviously, on the final lap. You're sitting there getting after it and trying to win the race. But Monday morning quarterback is something we all have the opportunity to do, but we're probably pretty aggravating, if you're your guy. So I thought the way you and AJ both handled that after the race was completely classic. I thought that was said a lot about you both, frankly.
We're truly good friends. That's the craziest thing is that Justin Haley, AJ Allmendinger, and myself are all actually friends with each other. Now we don't hang out that much away from the track, but we truly care about each other. And we truly, it's not just for teammates. It's truly friendship. And that's I've been in a lot of different race teams, not always for a long amount of time, but we all hit it off very early on last year. And he's such a professional. You know, he's done all this so much. And we, you know, Justin and I joke about it being older, and he's Uncle AJ. He's, you know, Justin calls him daddy, or calls him his dad. Like, it's they have this weird relationship, and then I'm like the cousin, or I don't know, something. I'm in the family, but, you know, maybe at arm's length. And, you know, we really do care about each other. So it's, you know, he's such a professional that when he gets out, he's done the TV side now. He can put into words what we're all thinking. Just in the moment, I'm hot. My heart rate is spiked. I was honestly confused. I got out of the car and I watched the video back, and I just like walked back and forth on pit road, like looking around. And I truly was confused as to what just happened. How did I just wreck coming to the checkered flag with my teammate? Like, at the end of the day, I wrecked my teammate, and that's terrible. I said it later, like, this is not going to help me move forward. I know that. I know that now that was a bad move, and I don't know how to let pick up.
Well, you got the rest of the season. Do you look at it like that? I got a little bit of racing before the playoffs start, and, you know, I'm in position with the most consistent team. We're going to have an opportunity, a real, real opportunity to try to win a championship. So you put that behind you and just try to go deliver what the man truly wants.
Yeah, that's the only way I really can is just get back to the race car. I wish we were racing Darlington today. You know, wish we were down there. That way I could just put everything out of sight, out of mind, and just go drive the race car.
All right, hey guys, let's take a break from this conversation real quick. Tell us about something you probably know.
FilterTime.com is a home air filter subscription service that sends you the exact air filters you need on the schedule you choose, so you never have to worry about buying air filters again. The box of brand new filters at your door, that's your reminder to change them. How much are the filters? They're the same price as you buy them. Okay. How much is shipping? Shipping is free.
That's nice.
Are there any contracts or fees? There are not. You can cancel with the click of a button. You can cancel. If you get backed up, you can pause or change your delivery schedule. Right? So say you've got filters piling up, you're ordering them too frequently, chose the every 2 months. Pause your delivery, or you can change the schedule right on the dot. To get started, you just go to filtertime.com/Dale Jr. Enter how many filters you have in your home and how often you want them shipped to you. You'll get 20% off your first order when you use the link
filtertime.com/deltuber. Filtertime.com air filters are made right here in North Carolina. We have three different quality filters to choose from that filter out things like pollen, mold, dust mites, bacteria, and dander, odors, and virus carriers.
Yeah.
We should do everything we can to improve the air quality in our home, and one of the best ways to do that is having a good quality air filter and changing that filter regularly. The biggest problem with HVAC issues in the home is a dirty air filter. You forget to change yours, I know I do. Get on Filter Time and you will never have that problem again. Right now, go to filtertime.com/deljr and get started 20% off your first order. We mentioned Spire, and we've got a car sitting here behind us. You're going to run a throwback. You know, Darlington is throwback weekend. Everybody comes with a great plan, and Spire's no different. So, first off, you know, explain your relationship with Spire, and you don't run every weekend for the team, but it seems like whenever they need you, you're part. You jump to the, you know, you jump into the action and get in there and do the work. So talk about your experience with that and what you get out of that. You race a full-time Xfinity Series, but you also get to drive this Cup car. I guess, if anything, you know, as a driver, you get to stay on top of where the Cup Series is. I know they got a new car coming in another year or two, but I think if you don't run this car, then, you know, the next time you get a Cup opportunity, you're just kind of way behind and having to play catch-up. So otherwise, I mean, you know, what do you get out of these one-off sort of racing in the Cup Series every other week?
Well, I mean, the biggest thing is probably the confidence that a Cup team, you know, wants to be in their car, and they, you know, they want to put tires on it and put the best effort they can, right? I mean, Peter Suspenso is my, one of my heroes. He's the crew chief on this car, and, you know, I mean, he's what he does with this group, and Pat Trice on the 15 with Brennan Poole, you know, what they do in that shop. I've watched it over the years. I've been there when it was a different race team with Corey Racing, and now see how they operate. I mean, Peter, he didn't back down from it. He doesn't put his cars on the pull-down rig. They had one in there. He's like, I don't need it. I know what we need to do, and I know what Packers and what gaps we need for each track. And you know, they really put forth their best effort. Like they really take care of me. So you're right, though. I mean, just keeping up to date, being in the garage is just important. And right now with COVID, you're not in the car. You can't go walk around. Just have your face. I used to do that in the Xfinity garage before I was full time. Just walk around and wave to the owners, wave to, you know, Mark Smith back in the day. You know, before I got to know him, just would make sure he always saw my face. And eventually got the driver race. That guy, but you know, it's just being there and right, keeping up on the technical side, you know, and just trying to be ready and be as prepared as I can be so I'm not the weakest link in a race car.
That is so true, man. I've tried to tell drivers, sometimes drivers lose their opportunities, and I'll tell them, like, man, just go to the garage and be seen. And they're like, I don't understand what that means or why I need to do that, or that feels weird. Walking around, you know, because the driver
doesn't. It does feel weird.
Yeah, a driver doesn't want to be anywhere where he doesn't have a role. And to go to the garage literally just to be seen feels strange. But you're right, the next time that owner that sees you in that garage on a regular basis needs somebody, you want him to think of you
first. Be the top of his head. Right?
Yes.
Yep.
And if you aren't there being seen, showing your face, you're going to easily get swept away and forgotten in the story. So that's great. I'll say that's advice for anybody else listening that's kind of maybe where you were several years ago. How to get the opportunities and become entrenched in the sport as you are today. That's one of the best ways to do it, is just go to the track and take your helmet, take your suit, and be ready. So Spire, Darlington, talk to us about this paint scheme.
Yeah, man, it's, you know, I haven't actually had many opportunities to do, you know, really planned out paint schemes, throwback paint schemes. And this is something that, was a little touch and go for a little while. We were going to be able to pull it off, but I'm glad we are, man. It's one that I'm guessing a lot of people won't remember, and they'll probably have to do some Googling to fact check us on this, but it's, you know, there's a reason that we're here with you today, man. It is one of your dad's old schemes. Goosebumps right now that the fact that I'm going to get to drive a paint scheme. He only drove it once, and it was early on in his career. But it's one that a lot of people might have forgotten. Really hope that they would start pulling that cover off while you're looking this way. But
you ready for the shit? You ready for everybody to see?
I guess.
Yeah, let's go ahead.
All right, let's do this. Is this thing sponsored though? Is it? You got a first sponsor?
So that's the other thing. We have a new sponsor to the Cup Series.
Right, a brand new sponsor.
All right, here it is. This Cup Car for Darlington. Here it comes. The Earnhardt Team. Oh yeah.
Oh, that's cool. Look at that gold
leaf on it all. What? Dirty Bohemia too? What?
What do you think, Matt?
So it's.
Look at Matthew. Holy
f***. Oh, sorry.
We have a cup car, don't we? Ross, I wish you could see the faces in this room right now.
Yeah.
I
can see Matthew's.
Can you see Matthew? Look at Matthew. Matthew, take a good look at it. Take your time. Look at this. And while you do that, take it in. Ross,
yeah.
And Dale, both of you, this paint scheme, when did Dale Earnhardt run?
76.
Yeah.
1976.
It might have been 76, 78.
Yeah.
Sometime around then. Johnny Ray owned the car, and Dad raced it in Atlanta. Was having a really reasonable top 10 day. Dick Brooks blew an engine in turn, I think 3 and 4, and was sliding down the track, and Dad came through there and wiped the boat out. Dad ripped the motor from his car, slipped down the bank, and took a couple pictures of the car. But so Dad wrecks the car, destroys it, brings it home to North Carolina. Johnny Ray was in Alabama. You know the truck that you drive around Talladega with the American flag on the back?
The redneck flyby?
Yeah. Yeah, Johnny Ray's truck.
Yeah.
So Johnny Ray lives near Alabama Speedway. They destroy the car. Dad takes it home to North Carolina. Robert G., my granddaddy and Dad, rebuilt it. This car was raced by Johnny Rutherford, eventually gets sold. Several other teams used it. I think before Johnny, it might have been a Daggard car with Darrell Waltrip and Donnie Allison. Because the paint scheme, they just bought the car, didn't even change the paint scheme. But you recognize that paint scheme through the years of Daggard. They had a number 77 on it. This car that you're looking at right now has gold leaf numbers. Beautiful. NASCAR's really relaxed some of the restrictions on numbers, reflective colors, and so forth. And so that really sets it off, the gold leaf numbers. And it's just such a pretty, beautiful, clean scheme. Thanks to Spire for allowing Dirty Mo Media to be a part of this. And we have a t-shirt
that
Ross is wearing.
Holy crap, that's cool.
Now, Ross, I designed this t-shirt.
Oh! Let's talk about this.
I mean, there's not much to the design, but we wanted to keep it clean.
Simple.
Yeah, clean. That's definitely 1970s design right there. You got a real clean-looking car on there. I can't wait to wear mine.
And by the way, I want you guys to know, the t-shirt designing process, Dale Jr. takes that as seriously as anything else. Yeah. I'm telling you, it's a high
t-shirt. Ross, no kidding. Me and Mike were up till what hour texting about this t-shirt last night.
We were.
So all the way to last night.
Which, by the way, and when he said, this is so funny. This is, if you know anything about Dale, let this be it. We've got graphic designers in the house. We got good ones. Man, I'm telling you, Ryan Williams, he can design with the best of them. He comes up with some fantastic little designs. I mean, just wait, we're going to have t-shirts. We're going to sell them, by the way, dirtymomedia.com. You'll be able to buy these shirts. Dale Jr. says, come in. I got the design. And he comes back and he texts us, well, was it an actual t-shirt that was, or was it just, a graphic? It was a graphic with no character of a car and no character lines. it basically, the way you could describe it is if you are into cartoons, think of the way South Park does their graphics. That would be this. Like, no character, no character lines, just the and man, if it ain't the cleanest, coolest looking retro like t-shirt.
Yeah, it's not too busy. It's something you'd wear at a bar, man, yeah, instead of those crazy t-shirts.
The car has all the character lines on it. It's too modern of a design to sort of mimic that retro 70s look. So we stripped all of it down. It's really clean. Plus, the colors, the red, white, and blue, the sponsor and all that pop really well with all that stuff going. So I just want to say, you know, thank you, Ross, for number one, for driving this car this weekend. You know, I know Spire feels the exact same way, but we here at Dirty Little Meat are so lucky to have a driver of your caliber behind the wheel.
Amen.
And I mean that because we had a lot of conversations internally about that. We were hoping to get the opportunity to work with you. And thanks to Spire for coming to us and us being able to create this partnership for this weekend.
Absolutely.
We're a growing business. And excited about the opportunity to we got a lot of great things that we're happy to, we got going on, and we got a lot of proud people here that work on this podcast and on all the things that Dirty Little Meat creates. And so this is a great opportunity for us. We're very thrilled to be a part of it. So we just want to, say thank you to Spire and Ross.
And you're our driver, buddy.
Yeah.
You are our driver.
Yeah, man.
You carry the torch.
It's a dream come true, man. We just get to run in this cup race at Darlington, let alone carry a scheme like this. But this has so many connections deeper than just the paint scheme with the Ray family. For me, Kevin Ray is a part of Spire, is a part of the family, and was a. I mean, what's crazy is I actually interviewed with him back when Tom Deloach had Red Horse Racing in the Truck Series, and Kevin was the president, I guess. I don't remember his technical title, but I interviewed with him at another sushi place in Mooresville back in like 2012, and I actually ordered a hamburger. Like I ordered a hamburger at the sushi place, and he just looked at me like, "World, like you want to drive one of our trucks, but you don't even order sushi."
At a sushi place.
At a sushi place. So from there to
either of them to growing, left lanes.
Red Horse, when Tom shut that down, to having Kevin be, helping on a lot of things. I actually did not ever get to meet his dad, but it's just something that having this connection to him, hopefully he's proud of this as well. And it's just, we're just trying to fight, man, and we appreciate you guys. Letting us do this, and I mean, a simple t-shirt, it's awesome. Need to have a few cold ones over it and celebrate this thing.
Yeah, it's a great shirt. We're gonna try to get some toddler size made for Isla, and Amy likes the shirt.
Does she
wants a toddler size? But I'm pumped. It's a great looking shirt. Kevin and me, we used to ride three wheelers out at his dad's place in Alabama when we'd go to Talladega race weekend. So me and Kevin used to hang out quite a bit. So we had. I know Kevin really well, and man, they had a dirt team that would go race over the short track at Talladega Short Track. They had dirt cars. I mean, Kevin's dad was they were a cool family. This is kind of a tribute to a lot of different people, I guess, in a way.
And Johnny passed away last year. Did we mention that? I think he passed away last year. No, you're right. There's all kinds of historical connections in this. By the way, I've caught you guys doing this too, but I keep peering over. I just can't stop looking at it. It's like we're at the maternity ward at the nursery looking at our baby for the first time. You know, we're all just like, you know. I mean, this is really how it feels right now.
So we try to keep it, like the simple design, I guess, it's as true as it can be with nothing on the hood. But
let's talk
this
about
thing
that.
Will happen. I cast fake as well. So that's... We know that. We know Lampy Sales are going to have that. That group is like family to us as well. So you can't see it from here, but they're on the deck lid. Knowing right now, we're going to have diecast.
We're going to have two types of diecast. Joe Mattis made sure that I knew that there was going to be autographed diecast and then the regular diecast. So you guys get ready. Y'all be doing some signing. I'm glad you mentioned the hood, because when I sent over a scheme, I think it was at the end of last week, Dale Jr. replied to me. He's like, y'all didn't put the logo on the hood. And I'm like, hey, Dale Earnhardt didn't have a logo on his hood. And so we're not. And I wanted to make sure that if this thing, if we had anything to do with it, we were going to keep this car as exactly like it was in 1976. And that's a pet peeve of mine, is that people, you know, all do these unveilings and, hey, this is our throwback car, but then they make it look like a billboard and you can't even tell what cars they're trying to throw back to. This one, yeah. You know where it came from. Straight out of 1976.
Truth be told, I wanted to slip Melon Man brand onto it. As soon as I thought it, I was like, what am I thinking? I can't do that. But we had to keep it simple, keep it true.
That's awesome. Well, y'all did an amazing job. Fire, congratulations, man. You have hit a home
yes.
run. I'm such a finicky or very judgy about paint schemes.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I had no idea. I can admit that. And, you know, I don't know if people really want to hear my opinion. Probably not. But I have an opinion about every single throwback that'll be out there this weekend. You guys are in the top shelf right here with this one. And I know I'm not, you know, Dad drove the car. I'm not being biased. This is so well done. It looks like the real thing on a modern shelf. So well done. Congratulations on the job well done on that. And just look forward to the race, man. I know you've got a busy weekend. Again, you know, as a driver, I know how busy you guys are. Y'all are pulled in so many different directions and doing Zoom calls all weekend long for media, for your race team, trying to prepare and think about what you got to do. I know you got two big jobs to do this weekend, one for Holly, one for Spire. And I'm looking forward to seeing that race car out on the racetrack. So that's beautiful, man. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, guys. I wish I had three. I wish I was running the truck race as well, but two will have to do. And I'll sleep good Sunday night. It's the challenge of running this cup car around here and keeping it clean is not easy. I'm looking forward to the challenge. So thank you guys again for letting us do this.
Well, I know Spire wouldn't want this, but if you do actually get you a dog for stripe, maybe you can put it on the saddle and I'll take the striped up side.
We'll put it in the studio.
I'd love to have some sheet metal, so I'm gonna go, oh, the 77 brushes the wall.
Yay!
Look at
that door!
Yippee!
Look at that door!
Spire gets a left, we'll get through.
Have fun this weekend. Thank you, Ross.
Yeah, thanks, guys.
Some of us have kids, and we all know this school year is going to be unlike any other. Whether your kids are going back to school or logging into a classroom from home, as parents, it can be time-consuming to give your kids that extra help that might need this. So there's a bit of help, hands-on science and art projects that you can get delivered right to your door. Our family at home is familiar with KiwiCo. We recently received a sensory box full of
three left lanes.
Stars. Just because, we got this box. We're playing with it, understanding what the difference is between the moon, a planet, a star, and obviously a rocket. That's pretty distinguishable for Isla. But planet,
yeah.
Right? She kind of knows what the moon is. She wants to look at it every night in the sky. So everywhere she sees a moon, she's going to point that out to me. Planet, what's new? That knew she'd know what planet was. Now, whenever she sees one, whether it's in a cartoon or whatever, she points it out. That's because we played with the sensory box from KiwiCo. She also learned what a rocket is. It's pretty interesting how they retained in that moment of, you know, playing with this sort of project from KiwiCo. She retained that bit of information and it's locked in.
That's pretty, how do they retain it? How does it stick? How do you get it to stick? That's the key, right?
So cool. But what is impressive to me is she'll see Saturn with the rings and she'll go planet.
Brilliant!
Planet. You know, it's like.
That's awesome.
And two.
She's ahead of her.
Two, and you're like.
Knowing the planet?
What planet?
Right.
Differentiating between the moon and the planet, like Saturn. Pretty impressive. Maybe not. Everyone. But,
it looks like the shred is up here.
Yeah,
all of us right now.
You're looking for those moments that you think they're going to be smarter.
Especially yourself.
I don't know.
Well, it was a lot of fun, and every
key all I see is the National
Guard's group. Pretty unique information, you know, that she can retain. Something that I wouldn't expect her to really have to necessarily need to know today. Something she's going to be taught at school. If she knows it, I didn't teach it to her. I feel like I had a role in it, but so that gave me a great feeling inside. But it's pretty cool when you're a little girl is understanding, you know, a rocket goes to the moon. Now she sees, I got this little rocket sort of model in my house, in my bedroom, next to the bed, kind of like she's like rocket. She sees it goes rocket. Obviously, it is the real looking rocket. Her Kimiko rocket is a little felt toy shape for the rocket. And how do they know the difference? Right? And she grabs it.
Wow. Got it. Brilliant.
We go down to the go-kart shop on my property where I got a bunch of old, out-of-date RC car equipment and stuff like that. A couple model rockets and stuff that we've been shooting in the sky tonight. Hadn't messed with those things for 15 years. They just sit on the shelf and she's seen the rocket. Can I hold it? Kimiko, your child can get super cool. Hands-on science, art, photography projects delivered to your door every month. And they'll be so excited to see you arrive in the mail. You will be, especially at a time when they might be unable to go out to fun places like museums, aquariums. Here's a really fun activity that comes straight to them. So do your part to encourage your children to be innovative. And thinkers. They won't believe what they can build and accomplish with KiwiCo. And when they're finished, watch their confidence be as big as their smile. There'll also be no commitment, so you can pause or cancel anything. KiwiCo is redefining learning with hands-on projects that build confidence, creativity, and critical thinking skills. There's something for every kid or kid heart in KiwiCo. Get your first month free on select crates at KiwiCo.com/Dale Jr. That's KiwiCo, KiwiCo.com/Dale Jr. My favorite part of the show is here. That's right. It's Ask Junior, brought to you by our friends at Xfinity Podcast Partner and Premier Partner of NASCAR. Let's hear what you guys have sent and Xfinity.
First question comes from Graham Wilson. He says, "Hey guys, love the podcast. I listen while I'm driving my truck here in the Pilbara area of Western Australia. I bought myself an RV over in the U.S. Once COVID is over and I can get out, what would be the best NASCAR race to watch when you come back?"
Watching camping. I'm in a Bristol night race. Camping in the Bristol areas of Waterfall, Rolling Hills, great campground outside that racetrack. I'm excited to be there. It's really great. And there's, you can get around and walk around the campground and sort of see a different vibe as you walk around the circumference of the racetrack outside. And there'll be stages. Yeah, I'm assuming that if y'all get back to where we'll be, there'll be a lot going on outside the racetrack that you'll enjoy. And the race, and a stadium like that here is the racetrack. A little track compared to, it's kind of like a college basketball, college football stadium. First race.
It's hard to argue that. As long as we draw the distinction between camping is not on the infield. Like, don't camp on the infield anywhere, because you're trying to watch the race too. He said both of them. Camp on the
so next
the,
year,
the outside of the track.
You know,
the
if I get that gig, right, where are you going to become a fan?
Walk
into the race. I'm gonna see you in a double zero shirt and stuff like that.
Just can't see much of
the race. Probably gonna be
be a negative.
All right, next question coming from Nicholas Goldie. He wants to know, what was your favorite throwback?
Oh, it'd be cheering on Mike Marvin.
He says, I have a few that I like, but my favorite
Mark
is
Mark. Mike Marvin. God damn, I can't talk.
Give you a favorite, somebody with another damn name.
Favorite paint schemes of all time.
I didn't know the damn name, it just flying went off my mind, just wasn't wanting to spit it out.
I guess to be honest, all of mine, in my opinion,
are
like B plus. I don't think I ever really
had a point. I mean, if I use that logic, I'd be a fan of Ryan Durbin, Joey Logano. I'd already be a fan of the Double Zero, Kimmy.
We all I'm just saying, all mine I never really
Bailey and Kyle.
There's all just a
I mean, like there's like a long list of drivers that I either know them or know people that work for them.
Like this car right here is in the A bracket.
Yeah, but I'm your buddy.
But a lot of things people
well, they're my buddies.
I was happy with them, but I just
I thought the Joey Logano one was actually just as funny.
Great Ghost is pretty good. But back then, they wouldn't
have I mean, like, you know, we're cool. Play some big words. We're not, like, you know, hugging it out or nothing. But, I mean,
all right, next question comes from Bernard Junior, what are your thoughts on Crowler's recent success in dirt? He's winning all major forms of dirt racing against the best dirt racing competition. Do you think he's headed back to NASCAR?
You know, I don't know.
Well, that's not very polite.
Nope. But I don't know why you would want to if you're doing all these things. When he was in NASCAR, he would say, I want to race dirt for a living. And here he is doing exactly
now,
what he wanted to.
Now,
I'd
be wrecked all the time before. I just didn't care. But now,
so why would
now
he
I hope you don't have a car left by the third race of the year.
He's basically, look at all the different types of cars that he's raced.
I would put that
he finally,
on y'all.
Right. Got a super late model dirt.
Well, I'm not being a dick, you are.
Nah, you're being a dick, dude. Maybe cry a little bit. I had a little bit of tear run down my cheek.
Yeah, he won the second one out. Yeah.
So,
when I asked
I
you if you
like
would be a fan, you said that's a negative.
I guess he won. I guess he feels like he's just
run down my cheek. Work. I think all those good. Like, I think he would be a fan of the whole fucking field. I mean, that's nice.
Question.
I was talking to
him. Honestly,
I was telling you, hurt my feelings.
And
of, like,
I sort of understand that a little bit.
You know, when you told me that, no, that's negative, and I said I had a little bit of tear roll down my cheek.
You're having
my feelings.
I mean, I know, like, people that, like, I mean, I'm on a, you know, that I'm friends with, which I don't, you know, I mean, but, you know, I mean,
more there is
friendly with and all that stuff, I'd have to be, I mean, I'd be a fan of the whole thing. I'd have to wear a different team shirt every day.
The fun gets kind of peeled away.
Instead, you don't even wear the hat of the company you work for.
You peel away. Racing is always fun.
I wear their fucking shirt. How much the damn space they tell you to get a tattoo on my penis?
You get to go to a short track with friends and jump the car and go out there.
That'd be a question for somebody else, not me.
You're never going
to have
as much
fun. How much space do they require? I wear this hat occasionally. I don't wear this much on day to day. I wear it whenever I think I might get caught for not wearing it when I'm at track for champions. But otherwise, champions, my job, champions not.
I don't know if you'll ever
what I do.
Have more fun than what he's
you've
doing
been caught
right
multiple
now.
Times. They just don't say nothing no
so,
more. At least if you don't care.
And you can always go back.
Foundation stuff is kind of personal. Yeah, Kevin and Todd kind of took it personal, dude.
You heard it. Don't forget, Dale's here every week to answer your question. So hit us up.
Add it under me. Don't care.
Hashtag Ask Junior for a chance to hear from Dale Jr. himself.
One last thing. Thanks to Xfinity for being a premier partner of NASCAR. Hey, Gilner, you got a great eye. His support.
Of course, if they would have, there's a real good chance I would have went. Oh, by the way, just tell me they claim to be so patriotic, doesn't give a fuck about the veterans. Active and active duty and former military people that kill themselves every day.
579 behind bars, my boy.
Oh, yeah.
And if you've never heard this one, both Dale and his longtime friend Bobby Allison had fallen out of the race early. They both hung around for a while until it started to rain.
You know that's what that one's for, right? What the 22 is.
And he was tired waiting out of the place. So he asked Neil to drive him to the airport in Florence so he could fly back home to Alabama. So they borrowed a van, headed to the airport.
Yeah, just like it's a double standard because
Bobby,
I know you and another couple people that were dropping Bobby off on the radio on the way back, and he heard that the rain had stopped. You get all hyper about shit. More fun than fucking you did. Fuck with me.
It was actually about the moment. So Neil put his right foot down and he sped back to the track as fast as he could. He wanted to beat the post race traffic to get inside the track.
Got worked up, got pissed off, got, you know, whatever. And so, They just assume whatever you're doing, trying to not
close down,
do whatever.
Everybody,
oh, well, you're getting worked up.
Diecast,
it's just a matter of time.
Will be available
like
at
pretty much your reputation.
Just,
and
I need
you
to make some hats.
Okay, worked up.
Make the hats, Dale. Let's just do it. For the sake of
people that don't know me at all.
Thank you, Dale. Thanks, everybody.
And it's your first damn year.
Thanks for Austin coming on.
I have no clue about my reputation and stuff like that.
Just a bit of badass.
And you better watch it, because it's a, just like you just said, it's a matter of time. It's a matter of time that I start cracking heads, too.
It's a group mentality. If we brought somebody in off the street that never laid eyes on any of us before, and out of the group of 20 of us or whatever it is at the shop someday, if out of that group there was 10 people that was picking with you or picking on you or whatever, that person would pick up on, oh, well, he, a lot of times they pick with, knowing that, a new guy will pick on somebody because everybody's picking. And they assume, oh, well, people pick on me. I don't think it's in person, so it doesn't continue on.
Oh, we got a great answer.
Whenever you take things like personal, like they are saying
this,
I've been called games or people made into windows about fucking me and shit like that. Now they talk about me and you fucking all the damn time. I just go, yes, he knows he's bottom this time. And at the end of it, you go into some great detail about putting green legs behind her head 460 degrees or some shit. And, I don't talk about bringing up what I do with my wife. But, you're in charge of your reputation and you can't take shit personal. Because I'm going to tell you right now, somebody in Daytona next year is going to call you a fucking dumbass. And you're going to take it personal. Because they were just pissed off about, for all you know, they just fucking hit their damn thumb with a fucking hammer and needed something else. And they're pissed off about their thumb, and you hit them the wrong thing because you misunderstood, because it's your first time, and they know that it's your first time, but in the heat of the moment, you're a fucking dumbass because they have to explain something. Because it happens to me. I mean, people look like, there's like 14 different types of fucking slugs on those stupid cars. There's only like three, but still, work with me. Sometimes I'll grab the wrong one because I'm not 100% sure what they're talking about, and they'll look at me like I'm retarded. I'm like, oh, fuck, okay, yeah, let me go grab something else. It happens, but you can't take it personal. I've been cussed by somebody and laughing with them at the end of the same day. But you got to be able to do that there. Here is trying to, fucking just ride out the end of the damn year. People aren't going to change how they are towards you in 7 weeks enough to where it's going to be something worth even fucking fighting for. Just try to roll with it. Fucking laugh a lot of shit. Don't take shit personal. Don't get pissed off and walk away. There's no telling. As a general rule, most people here don't dislike you. I know everybody, you want to believe everybody does. But they don't.
I bought one.
They like fucking with you because it's like a reality TV show. Everybody watches reality TV show for the drama. They don't watch it to see somebody go to bed at night. You just gotta learn how to handle the situations. Because on the racing, they're gonna be a lot worse because they're under a lot more pressure than anything a champion.
Yeah. I know that.
The water.
It's funny though, what you said about how people not like me here because
project in clear. When they make this game,
your personality with some people is very,
You never make it as a company.
You're one of those people that, somebody like Bryce, somebody like me, somebody like, you know,
Delaney
Nicholson, Nate, you know, the ones that they're kind of, whatever. We fuck with you, but we know when to stop.
Look at it and says, okay, this room is...
We go, you know, we understand how, we've dealt with you more than, or, you know, we've been around you more, most, you know, some of us are more, you know, away from the job and all that stuff, we've been away from you. People like Vestals or Mudhole, whatever, they just run their mouth anyway. Whenever, and then whenever they get that little bit of a, you know, a little bit of a rise out of you, they just keep it going. And then you get pissed off, and you say, you know, whatever, you know, like you invest in pissed and match for half a fucking year, the whole time I was watching it, it's stupid. It was. Between the both of you, you both did stupid shit. And, you know, but yeah, that turns people off to, like, you know, okay. I mean, Vestal, you know, everybody's cool with Vestal. I personally
found their guy.
I guess they're friends as far as work goes. I've never hung out with him outside of work. So, lower in the tracks, or, you know, money or whatever. But, you know, I mean,
you would be surprised.
Like, everybody looks at you like you're an idiot.
Yeah, you know the whole story behind that, pretty much. not life. I've been like done and called that or stuff like that. But there's a deer right there.
But we went through the whole story.
I'm not worried about it anymore. I just buy my time for the rest of the year. Hopefully, I get something new.
Which is, you know, if anybody wants to hear that,
that reputation doesn't follow me over to something new, which it probably will, because the same people are going to be there.
You went through a methodical process to get that confirmed. So, yeah, carry on.
You go somewhere new. When people fuck with you, and you got to learn how to fuck with people.
Off in a day,
a lot of times you start out good, and you like overkill it. Like you go a little too far with your like, you know.
It's right there.
Somebody talks about you know,
rolling.
Sucking dick, and you start talking about getting people sucking your teeth. That's not shit I'm gonna hear about. You're talking about green, putting your leg behind your head, or you putting green leg behind her head. But for the love of God, don't talk to somebody about that. That's about a damn hoodie string. But, you know, about half of what you do whenever you're like whenever people are like kind of got that banter going back and forth, about half of it where you need to like leave it. Because a lot of times you get a little too realistic or something. I don't know. But it's just, Everybody's going, oh, yeah, he is that way. But if you kind of go in, fresh start, new page, how I'm going to handle things, and try to live by it. And, I mean, your reputation starts from square one, not, you know, you're not behind like you are right now with your, you know, with the way things are, champion.
Listen, that's legit. Because,
and by the way, the thing with the main stream was a complete joke.
That almost happened to us.
You know, because Chris was always talking about the bench drafts and stuff like that, so I was deciding to joke around about that hoodie stream. Because there was a hoodie stream, and we were, you know, not like sexual playing around. We were just fucking messing around, and I tied her arm up. And that's where that hoodie stream came up.
And he's like,
I don't care. I've never cared, but, you know, that's one of those. That was one of those situations where if you say something, you gotta kind of deal with it, like, and, you know, that's like the damn bus thing. You get mad about the bus, but you don't want to drive the fucking bus. If it was me and they were saying that shit about me, about, well, you know, we about went over and all that stuff.
I don't understand what the hell's going on.
Yeah, well, yeah. The whole thing is when you sit there and literally make me like I'm an idiot when, you know, y'all keep coming up with all the road move. That is not what I said. I said the road fell away is what I said. And then y'all turned it into the road.
Like I said, I mean, I didn't care. Hell, I didn't care to know. In fact, I was going to land on prayer. Prayer was going to land on me, and I was going to be with that way. But the fact is, like, with that situation, who cares? Like, you know, you're making me look like, I fucking called damn Nate a virgin for about the first, tell fucking COVID shit. Like, I kept talking about how he was a virgin, and it would get him aggravated. It'd get him worked up, and just, you know, I would just, you know, and he knew I was fucking with him. But he'd be like, he, like, sent girl messages. And, like, you know, will you tell this motherfucker he was a virgin? And it got him so worked up, I got Bryson went on. So, and then after a while, you know, I forget what even happened, and he's like, well, if I do this, or whatever, you know, I forget what was done, what was said, he's like, you know, but I mean, like, it got under his skin, and so we kept doing it, and then finally, it just kind of went away. There's shit that they fucked with you last year, they fucked with you about this year, but every time they find something they fuck with you about, you get all, they're making me look like an idiot, no, they're not. The only thing that makes you look like an idiot is if you get pissed off about them saying something stupid, pissed fucking what you said. And go, like I said, if you just went, well, they drove, or, hey, I haven't had to drive the bus since then either, have I? And, you know, then they would have been like, well, fucker, you can drive it next week. They're like, well, I guess I just tried to scare y'all worse then. I mean, you know, it's not making you look like an idiot.
No, I have done the whole deal, and I haven't had to drive the bus since, and it's been thrown at me, yeah, because I tried to kill everybody, that's why. So, yeah, that one doesn't work. I've done that already, but the whole thing is, I've been driving for 14 plus damn years, never had a damn accident, never tore up anything, don't tear up shit, pay attention to what the fuck I'm doing. That really bothered me, John. Like, honestly, really fucking bothered me. I mean, the edge of the road, you know, fucking just fell away, you know, and it happens even when we're driving the big trucks and stuff like that. Like, all of a sudden, you'll get in one of those construction zones and they'll have a fucking 30-foot fucking lip or something like that, you know, and that bothered me, because how long I've been driving safe and everything like that and haven't had an issue, and then I drive that stupid fucking bus that one damn time down a little tiny fucking road that it shouldn't have been on in the first damn place, and that happens. So yeah, that really bothers me. It really does bother me.
Bring it up. People still talk about it. That was Kentucky. Fuck, that was 4 months ago.
I mean, and as much as we've been on the bus this year, they've talked about that as much as they talked about the road and shit like that with you. And the fact is, the fact you haven't been in an accident is extremely lucky. The fact that I haven't been in an accident is extremely lucky. Because, I gotta be honest with you, I think it's something like 99% of drivers think they're the best drivers on the road, but the fact of the matter is, can't none of the fucking driver win with a wet paper bag because you don't know what the guy in front of you is going to do. You don't know what the guy beside you is going to do. You don't know if the bird's going to fucking fly through your windshield. You don't know what, you know, the fucking road. The hell, the sinkhole's open the fuck up anymore. I mean, there's 9 million things, and every time you get in a corner, it can go wrong. You start questioning whether or not, you know, there's times that I've seen the side of that truck, or I've seen your fucking fifth wheel before you turn it sharp to go around shit, and you might have been reacting to something, or you might have been doing, you know, or you might have just been aggravated. Like whenever you know, I've seen you cut off people because you were mad. It's not the safest thing in the world to do, cutting off a fucking tractor trailer, and you know, so yeah, the fact.
Chris, the guy from Champion? Are you talking about him? No. He ain't going nowhere. Been going on here lately with me. in a few weeks, we will all know. People already know, but when we were in home for Richmond, after Richmond, before we went to Bristol, I had an interview with the 00. To run by himself, I guess, because we were talking to him yesterday, finding out if he was going to come up there to pilot. He stopped early, so he's running by himself. He's probably behind us by at least probably 200-300 miles, more likely. They're going to have the option to watch and run too. Or when they watch both of us. I don't know. So wherever I go, I'm still going to try to do live streams. If people want me to. Now I run a totally different schedule than what Ron does, so that's why people come and see me when they're not able to watch Ron. But if I was on that same schedule as Ron, would they keep watching me? That's what I gotta weigh and see. Just some of the things ain't going through my head, that's all. The good thing is I have another microphone, but it's in the phone.
Might get a little tricky to get to.
to stop for that 30, so I can be 3 hours closer to parking for another 10-hour break.
I hear you. I don't know what it is. You know, I was good to go when we woke up, but now I'm like dragging. I'm like,
Well, like I said, this time of day is always bad for me.
Yeah, that's when I start feeling it too, is around this time of day.
That's why I want to get up whenever our 10 hours is up, try to beat feet on to Vegas, because then we'd be parked somewhere. By this time, I'll be able to go to sleep and actually sleep.
Maybe I can get my subs up over the off season by doing gaming and stuff like that on YouTube. Tech's gonna help me set that up and everything like that, and maybe I can be able to live stream on YouTube next season. Depending on what I'm doing though. If I'm driving a dump truck, I probably won't live stream. That's boring. People don't want to see me driving a dump truck.
according to my GPS on my phone, we might be hard pressed to make it to Albuquerque to stop. We might stop short of Albuquerque. Really? Yeah, we're about 17 minutes shy of making it to that blind day near Albuquerque. What changed? Well, it was always going to be a stretch. We just hadn't made up the time like I thought we would.
Yeah, these damn 60 mile an hour one lane bullshits ain't helping either.
Yeah.
Ain't no damn work going on.
I'll look at it again whenever we get up here and stop for fuel here in a couple hours, see if we make up any more time. Yeah, it's not. We got it 5 over the whole way, but I don't know if it's factoring any damn trouble zone or not into that. Five over the whole time. The next 6 hours should make it. Otherwise, it's gonna be I don't know what about the people around there, but they're too tall. Yeah, they were.
Yeah. a not dump truck also, Jake. '90s, yeah. I'm not surprised. Air quality is probably gonna be pretty bad too because all the fires.
Hoping we get another minivan.